when we get discouraged about discouragement training, we say, God, it's not working. It's terrible. We need to give up this discouragement training. What happens is then there's these special squads of encouragers that come into a world. Let's say like this world, we got very discouraged. So you know what? We got discouraged with discouragement. We say, you know what? I think it's enough of this. So in comes this huge influx of discouragement loyalists. Discouragement loyalists, and they say, "Oh no, oh, okay, you know, don't worry. We'll remotivate you. We'll remotivate you to stick with this discouragement training. This whole universe is just our discouragement training program that we believe discouragement will give us this capacity to incapacitate perfection, such that we can locate a supposed flaw that perfection's hiding from us and fix the flaw, and they'll be able to be prior to perfection. We believe that perfection doesn't want us to be prior to perfection, so it's hiding, it's hiding this flaw that if we find it, we'll be and fix it, we'll be able to be prior to perfection. But this is just all made up. I mean, it's not true. There is no flaw in perfection to find at all. So all this discouragement training is completely useless, actually. So we do say, you know what, I believe that, you know, this isn't really, we don't really need to be doing this. So into this world comes this huge squad of discouragement motivators. They want to remotivate us. They say, okay, we see you're discouraged. We understand this. We're going to make you much more comfortable, much more materialistically comfortable. You don't have nice enough houses and cars and things, and we're going to give you all this stuff. So what happens is these are super materialistic people, a focus of how do we produce this, you know, world of things so everybody is happy enough to keep on with the discouragement training. So that's half of it. The other half is those people come in with spirituality people, love and light spirituality people, who say, oh, you know, we're going to teach you how to be full of love and light so you won't give up on this discouragement training situation. So the loyalist squads of discouragement encouragers have two parts, the spiritual and materialistic side. We both come into the world at the same time. So we say, oh yeah, we can have our, you know, we have all this, you know, luxury and travel and cruises and stuff, but we also got some yoga, you know, and some people talking about how everyone's is full of love and, you know, all the spirituality stuff. So we say, oh, this discouragement training is not so bad. I kind of like it a little bit. It's not as bad as it used to be. That is what's happening in the world, exactly what's happening in the world. This world got to a point where it was saying, hey, you know what? Time, you know, this is not working. Discouragement training doesn't work. I think we want to give it up. And like the universe is like extremely nervous about this, because the whole universe is just discouragement training. It's our discouragement training. We designed it. And it rushes in and says, oh, no, don't give up. You know, if you give up, we might all give up. Then we'll all be unhappy forever. You know, we think we have to. We think we have a need to do this. That's the whole problem. It's a desire, not a need. 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 Yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. So again, the crux of this video we've talked about already is that when we get ready to give up this discouragement training of a world, of this world, of this universe, that's all it is, a discouragement training that we designed to try and develop capacity to incapacitate perfection and locate a flaw in perfection to fix it so we can be prior to perfection without this feeling of intolerable separation arising. When we get discouraged and say, want to give this up, give up discouragement training, the universe sends in the encouragement troops, the encouragers, the loyalists, the discouragement training loyalists. They're all trained. They send them in like a you know, EMT, emergency EMT team. And says, hey, you know, don't worry, don't give up yet. There's a lot of good stuff coming here. Don't give up yet. A lot of good stuff. You know, you're going to have, gee whiz, you're going to have cell phones and artificial intelligence and electric cars and all these, you know, genetic engineering and microdosing drug cocktails and you know, all these spiritual stuff. You can attend a seminar and something. You can listen to people talk about light and love and happiness and peace and harmony and equality and all these things. And we're going to make the whole world like all full of wonderful harmony and fellowship and all these things. So they hype it up. That's just superficial, you know. So we don't quit. We don't say, oh, no, it's still terrible, you know. Oh, wait a minute, AI, you know, maybe what AIs might do something for us, that kind of thing. Or look at all these new products. I go into a store, oh, it's all new products. Gee, I didn't see all this stuff before. Like, it might be that. It's nice to buy this and nice to buy that. And, you know, constant turnover of products. So we don't just say, this is all so lousy. I'm so discouraged. Forget it. I don't like this. Training's terrible. So we're in the midst of this intense encouragement. Towards holding on to discouragement. We're being encouraged to hold on to discouragement in this world right now. It's the most intense it's ever been. It's an all-out push so that we don't quit. What happened was in the late 19th and 20th century, there was a whole lot of great spiritual coaches here, true spiritual coaches, a huge amount. It was amazing. And the world, we were starting to say, hey, you know what? There's a way out of all of this. We don't need to keep being suffering and dying and subject to vulnerability and all these things. We don't need to do this, actually. And this world's not even our home at all. You know, this realm of conditioned existence is not our home. We had a huge spiritual uplift, and that freaked the universe out. It says, oh, no, that's going to ruin my discouragement training program here. And, well, we said that. Spirit did. But the universe reflected it. And so there was this huge push to get us back, you know, get away from that and re-enmesh ourselves in this discouragement training and forget all about, you know, the truth here. Forget all about it. This is what's happened. It's the backlash to the spiritual uplift that we had over the last couple of centuries. It's the backlash now. We're experiencing the backlash. And it's incredibly severe, incredibly severe. But we're also here, we're providing this context, and we're like saying, oh, this is helpful context. I didn't expect to have such great context here. This is like really helpful, this context. Wow. Just looking at it like this, I see it, oh, okay. Because, you know, the spirituality folks that they're blah, 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 the spirituality stuff, that's not what the great spiritual coaches are like. You know, like Ram Maharshi, he didn't talk about spirituality or any of that kind of stuff. No, he just said practice. And then you'll realize that this whole universe and all the gods and goddesses and deities and everything, forces, it's all just our imagination. It's just all our imagination. There's much to do about nothing at all. Jesus has said the same thing. Sri 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 Nanamaya Ma, similar to that, you know, she says that. You can never be satisfied with this place, so why do you keep trying? Why do you keep trying? You know, it's just, that's true. They're not talking about love and light and spirituality stuff, forces, you know, and all psychic powers and all these various things, the spiritual. They're not saying stuff like that. Buddha never says stuff like that. No. That's just to keep us spellbound with our discouragement scheme so we don't give up on it. We feel if we give up on it, we'll be perpetually unhappy because we think it's a need. We need to do this, and if we don't do it, that'll make us unhappy. So the confusion between desire and need is, in looking at this, is essential, and just become aware that this is the key, super key area here, the difference between desire and need. You know, we desired to change perfection. We desired that there be a flaw in perfection. That doesn't mean there's a flaw. It's just a desire. A desire doesn't create reality. The desire that can't change the intrinsic nature of reality at all. It can have a dream of potentiality. It can't actually do it, though. So we cannot introduce imperfection into perfection. It's totally impossible. But we desire to do it. But a desire is not a need. The only need we have is to function the way we were created to function, which is perfect freedom and equality, perfect equality of freedom, and to function in that context. That's the only need there is. That's just an intrinsic need. So we don't have any need to change reality. We don't have any need. It's a desire. It's a whimsical desire. But in order to hold on to this training program, we've hyped it, and we're saying, oh no, it's not a desire, because if it's a desire, we can give it up. They say, no, it's a need. It's a need. We have to do it. We have to do it. It's a need. So we've believed our own marketing, our motivational marketing, and taken that to be actually the truth of the situation. No, it's just the hype, the way we've been motivating ourselves. It's not an actual need at all. So Once we see it's a desire, not a need, then we're not so fearful of giving it up. We say, oh no, it's just silly desire I had, that's all. So, it's a desire, not a need. We say, marketing desire as need, so I don't give up. Marketing desire as I need, so I don't give up. Marketing desire as need, so I don't give up. Marketing desire as need, so I don't give up. Just marketing desire as need, so I don't give up. Marketing desire as need, so I don't give up. Marketing desire as need, so I don't give up. Marketing desire as need, so I don't give up. So we've been marketing desire as if it were need, so we don't give up the discouragement training. But the problem is then we got confused and we're now viewing it as a need. So that's why we think when we're starting to give up in this world, we say, hey, wait a minute, this is the desire, not need. The universe sends the squad of encouragers, you know, discouragement encouragers, says, oh, no, you can't give up. It's a need. If you give up, we'll all end up giving up and we'll then be suffering forevermore, you know, in the torment of hell or something, because it's a need. We have to do this. Totally untrue. It's a whimsical desire. The whimsical desire to that there be a flaw in perfection that we can fix so we can experience being prior to perfection without the feeling of intolerable separation arising, that's a whimsical desire on our part. It's not a need. We don't need to experience being prior to perfection with a different effect than the intolerable feeling of separation. The intolerable feeling of separation is the only a way we can imagine being prior to perfection. Is this feeling of intolerable separation? Like I'm not part of what is intrinsic, intrinsic and perfect, and I'm separate from it. That's the only way you can do it. So there's no way. We desired to have a different effect from that idea, but there isn't any way to get that. Just because we desire it doesn't mean that we can make it so. We can't go and say, oh, the reason why we were experiencing this feeling of intolerable separation when we have the idea of being prior to perfection is because there's a flaw in perfection. And so, but if we fix that flaw, we'll be able to do it. That is just made up. We made it up out of desire to experience this idea in a different way. Out of desire experiencing this idea of being prior to perfection in a different way, we simply had this desire, we made up this notion that there's an imperfection, and we can fix it. And then we also made up, when we couldn't find it, we can't find it, we said, oh, we can't find it because perfection's hiding it from us. That's why we can't find it. Not because it's not there, but because perfection's hiding it from us. That's just another desire. See, we desire it to be there, so when we're confronted with the fact it's not there, we desire says, oh, it's there, but perfection's hiding it from us. So then, that's when we got into this discouragement training, because we wanted to find a capacity, we wanted to empower ourselves with the capacity to incapacitate perfection to the extent that then we can locate that flaw in perfection and fix it. All of this is just desire-based, made-up desire, fantasy land, you know, fantasy land. It's just wishful, hopeful, desire-based hope, kind of, right? Like, oh, if this were so, then I could, but it's not so, kind of thing, yeah? It's not so. So we don't need to try and develop a capacity to incapacitate perfection at all, and we can't. We cannot develop such a capacity. Impossible, so all our efforts to develop it are fruitless, equally futile. Holy Spirit's final judgment is that it's all equally futile, and this reassures us that perfection is still, there's perfect equality in perfection, because there's been no success in doing the impossible from anyone. Okay, so nobody has gained some sort of inequality, sort of, there's no inequality situation that could possibly take place in perfection. If somebody could actually make progress towards doing the impossible, then there'd be inequality and perfection, right? The rest of us wouldn't have made any progress, and some have made progress. Then we couldn't function, perfection wouldn't function properly at all. So we have to be reassured that there's no inequality in perfection. All of us have equal futility in trying to develop capacity to incapacitate perfection. Equal futility. Yes. Get a little chilly out here as it's starting to storm. How about that? That's amazing. Just yesterday was 80 plus here, and now it's like cold and rainy. Whew, we're not used to that here. Whew, it's suddenly gotten very cold here. So we did put on your poncho. Come on, what else could you do? Right? And it's like that, it's all good. And we're continuing here this wonderful Saturday morning here. Last month, and then May started out even more hectic. I think, you know, people are dropping out, not so many viewers, because things are just getting so hectic in probably people's lives. And of course, the encouragement squad is in the world, encouraging us to remain loyal to discouragement training, is in the house now. And they're absolutely going now full on to say, hey, don't miss this encouragement training we're giving you to remain loyal. You got to remain loyal, or else you're going to be unhappy forever. They're giving you that sort of thing. And so this is intimidating people, unfortunately. But we're able to address this here very, very, very effectively and stay on point. So, and this storm, you know, will be pretty strong, and it's going to clear out at the end, in the afternoon, actually. Just a quick moving storm that's pretty unusual this time of year. So, but in the world, there is this intense storm of what we call false encouragement, which means to stay loyal to this discouragement scheme as if it were a need. So the false encouragers claim that we need to be here in this world. We need to take this training. We don't need to be in this world. We don't need to be in this universe. We don't need to take the training. It's all desire-based. We desire to be in, have this universe. We desire to have this world. We desire discouragement training. It's never, ever a need. It's just a silly, whimsical desire on our part to try and experience being prior to perfection without this feeling of intolerable separation arising. It's just a simple, silly desire is all it is, never a need. So this is what's the crucial, crucial difference here in the messaging. And the discouragement encouragers claim we need, we need to do this, we need to do this, we need, it's a 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 need. The only thing we need to do is recognize that it's not a need. Needs to realize that desire is not a need. Okay, and once that's cleared up, then there's no more troubles at all. But that does have to happen. We have to recognize it, that desire is not, can't become a need. Cannot become a need. Cannot become a need. Cannot introduce imperfection into perfection. Cannot change perfection. Cannot train us how to incapacitate perfection. Can't do any of that. Has no capability of doing that whatsoever. Zero capability. Zero capability. Zero capability. Zero capability. Yes, yes, yes. So we've been marketing desire as need to help us not give up. Marketing desire is a need to help us not give up. Marketing desire is a need to help us keep trying. Marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. Marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. So these discouragement encouragers have come into this world. The super materialists and the spirituality talks folks. They've come in here to encourage us to maintain our discouragement training. They've told, and they're telling us, you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do this. Totally untrue, totally false message, totally false message. Okay, but this is what's happening in the world. So you need to counter that, counteract this by listening to these videos here and getting the context of the entire situation, and don't sweat all the details. The details are not really, no need to sweat any of that. Just say, marketing desire as need to help me not, to help me keep trying. Marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. Marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. So just be aware, they're marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. Marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. So these discouragement encouragers are marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. They're marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. They're marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. They're marketing desire as need to help us keep trying. This goes on and on and on and on. When does that ever end? As long as we keep with this discouragement training, which is again trying to develop capacity to incapacitate perfection so we can supposedly locate a flaw that we believe perfection's been hiding and fix it. As long as we keep with this discouragement training, you're going to get discouraged about the discouragement training. And you say, wow, I'm so tired of doing this. I don't think it works. It's never going to work. How do I get free of this? And then you can either listen to the Holy Spirit, grace, which says you don't have to keep doing it. It's just a desire. It's not a need at all. Or you can listen to the discouragement encouragers who will say, oh no, it's a need. You got to do it. There's no choice. You have to do this, but don't worry. We'll encourage you to keep doing this. What do you need? What do you need from us? What do you need from us? You need some like fancy digital technology? Oh sure, we'll bring that in for you. It's like hospice. You need something. What do you need? What do you need? We'll bring it in for you. You need some meds. You need this. You need this. You need this. Oh no, don't worry. We'll deliver it to you. You know, this kind of thing. Like just stay loyal to dying. You know, stay loyal to discouragement. You got to stay loyal to this until we finally develop that capacity. So they want you to stay loyal to death, discouragement, sickness, the whole discouragement thing. They say no, this will eventually develop the capacity to incapacitate perfection. No, it won't. No, it won't. They say, well, you need to develop it. No, we don't. It's a desire, not a need. Desire, not a need. Desire, not a need. Desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need. Desire, not a need. Desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need. Desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. So just keep practicing like this. This is like maybe an extremely helpful practice right now. Under the circumstances, you know, we have to rely upon extremely effective practicing. It's a desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. The difference between these practices and what's going on with all these discouragement encouragers and all their spirituality talk is that you don't hear all this fancy spirituality talk about, you know, love and light and all this kind of stuff. We're just saying, it's a desire, not a need. It's a desire, not a need. It's a desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. Just like that. So you can see it's very different, right, than a lot of, you know, all the spirituality stuff in the world. It's very different. Of course it's different. Because we have a different aim, right? We aim to help you recognize it's a desire, not a need. Where they're insisting it's a need, not a desire. Completely different. So, you know, we don't have to, you know, do all this fancy, you know, icing on the cake of discouragement, all the spirituality icing on the cake of discouragement. No. So it's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. Like that. This is what's extremely helpful. And the thing is, you might think like, but I'm not doing all this fancy spirituality training, you know, that seems everybody's doing that, it's so important. Well, those are the discouragement encouragers doing that to keep you believing that it's a need. You need to succeed with this, the training, discouragement training, and they're helping you feel like this is important. This is like really spiritual what we're doing. What's spiritual about trying to discourage ourselves to develop the capacity, so we develop a capacity to incapacitate perfection? What's spiritual about that? That's just silliness, absurdity, whimsical absurdity. That's not really, why you call that spirit? Why would we call that spiritual? Perfection doesn't call itself spiritual. You know, perfection just is. Perfection is perfection is perfection. Yes, yes, yes. There's no thought like, hey, I'm really being very spiritual here or something. It's not like that. So, you know, don't worry like, well, I'm falling behind in the spirituality training that they're giving here. They're giving all the spirituality training and blah 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 blah, endless stuff. I go through it, you know, online, and I just see what people are, what they're saying, and it's just like, it's so discouraging what they're saying, because they just completely miss the point, you know, entirely avoid the gist of it. Entirely avoid the gist of it. That is that we're just saying the gist of it is all you need to hear. It's a desire, not a need. It's a desire, not a need. It's a desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. That's all you know. This is the focus. But we think like, oh, I'm missing out. I'm falling behind. I'm not becoming spiritual enough. You know, I'm not doing all this spirituality stuff. That's just rhetoric. Yeah, that's just rhetoric and playing with ideas and concepts and putting icing on the cake of discouragement so we don't give up. That's all it is. You don't have to engage in all this flowery spirituality talk at all. You're not falling behind. They're just staying loyal to discouragement by putting this kind of icing on the discouragement cake. So we need to remind ourselves, hey, it's not Indeed, it's a desire. This discouragement training, which is what this world is, that's all this world is discouragement training. This universe is a desire that we're having, not a need. A desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need. Desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. A desire, not a need. Yes, yes, yes. So, but these folks, these discouragement encouragers, they know their business. You know, they're professionals at what they do. They're pushing it so strong on the whole world. The whole world is under this dark, dark cloud of discouragement encouragement. What darker cloud could there be than discouragement encouragement? Okay. Isn't that the darkest cloud of all? And yet it's a cloud that calls itself light and love. They got this dark, dark cloud of light and love for you, folks. That's what it is. It's the most, you know, to encourage your continuance of discouragement training by continuing to hype it as a need, that's the darkest, darkest cloud of all. But it masquerades as light and love. It's like, no, we're here to help you lighten up. Lighten up. Help you lighten up. It's like trying to get spaciousness, like all-pervasive spaciousness by, you know, raising the ceiling in your kitchen and dining room or something. You know, let's it was 8 feet, now like let's raise it up to like, you know, 10 feet. That's more spacious. Now I'm experiencing spaciousness. That's what people are doing in their homes. They're remodeling their homes and just making them more spacious. And I say, oh, now I'm living in spaciousness. How encouraging is that? You know, I love that. I like that. Instead of experiencing the all-pervasive spaciousness. It's like that. You know, Dan, let's all remodel our homes. That'll make us happy. You know, give us a little more spacious feeling in our homes. That's what's happening. That's all the whole materialistic spirit. It's called spiritual materialism. Spiritual materialism. Spiritual materialism. These spiritual materialistic shock troops are in the world right now. They have been, and they're now, you know, really, 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 really pushing it to the max, pushing it, hyping it like crazy. And of course, they're holding out futures. Say, hey, you know, we got these terrific drugs, you know, and we're figuring out how to combine them in the right way. AI is going to help us, you know, get the exact right combinations. And then you're going to be able to have those combinations. You get up in the morning and you take this little microdose of drugs and you're going to feel like, you're going to feel fantastic the whole day long. You say, like, wow, what a great day. I'm so happy to be here in this discouragement training program, you know, fantastic. And so people are like, oh, that's really encouraging. Yeah, okay. it's like attracting a moth, you know, to a flame. You know, they say, wow, that's so amazing. Can't miss that. You know, same thing with AI. I can't miss that. All these, you know, artistic people are like, oh my God, we can't miss this. You know, this is like, and they're saying, well, I hate this, but you know, but there's a lot of things I can do with this. You know, that kind of thing. It's just silliness, you know, it's just absolute silliness. So it's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. A desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. It's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, yes, yes, yes. That's it. So this is extremely helpful to just practice in this way. It's a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need, a desire, not a need. Yes, 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 keep telling yourself throughout the day. And the whole key is to actually do it. Because if you don't do it, these discouragement encouragers, they're going to get their hooks into you. They already got their hooks into the world, you know, in extreme fashion. And you're going to keep, you say, oh, wow, look what I can have in the future. It's looking like, you know, the future could be really encouraging here. You know, all this stuff, you know. And it's coming, you know. So you can't, it's not like it's not coming. All this stuff is coming. AI and biotech is huge in like Silicon Bay Area. It's all about AI, biotech and AI. And the combination of robotics, artificial intelligence driven robotics and biotech. Biotechnology, which is going to be, you know, implanting chips in everybody, and producing microdose drug cocktails for everybody. That's huge. This is what's coming in the world here. You know, just like the computers were invented here in the Silicon Valley, a couple miles away from where I live. And look how huge that's become in the world. It's completely taken over the world, hasn't it? Well, so will this, you know, robotics and surgery and biotech, drug cocktails and all that stuff. That's going to take over the world too. Well, to keep you encouraged. Keep you encouraged. Look, the robots will do all this work for you. You can sit back in your patio on these drug cocktails and do virtual reality trips throughout the universe. This is what's going to happen. You'll have a really nice patio with a hot tub, and then you'll have virtual reality setups, and you will then have your drug cocktails, and you have your robotic servants doing stuff, and then you'll just take just spend your time just ego tripping throughout the worlds of discouragement worlds, discouragement worlds, like, oh wow, let's go. Yeah, this is what's going to be the future. It's going to be like that for sure. They already have all the virtual reality stuff, but that didn't quite catch on yet because they didn't have the other stuff figured out quite yet, the drug cocktail, microdosing drug cocktail thing, and artificial intelligence to administer the whole situation, and then the robotic surgeries, where you're going to get various implants and stuff to enhance your experiencing, and also to keep track of you so they know what kind of drug cocktail to give you. You see, all this data is going to be accessible to quantum computers, and they will, in real time, keeping track of everybody so they can tweak their drug cocktails and tweak their virtual reality experiences and all this stuff. So people are intrigued by the future because of this. But all this does is it keeps us loyal to this discouragement training of believing you're a body in a world, in a universe with forces that you're subject to, and all this nonsense of gain and loss, birth and aging and death, all these things, all the vulnerabilities, all this stuff is just a play of vulnerability, this discouragement training. And we believe that by training ourselves to get used to this, we'll develop a capacity then to discourage perfection, so that it's somewhat incapacitate perfection enough to locate that supposed flaw. It's a non-existent flaw. It doesn't exist, but we desire that there be a flaw. We believe we'll be able to locate the flaw and fix it. It's all just make-believe. There's no flaw there. There's no flaw to locate. But the future seems very intriguing to people here. And people are they're hypnotized by the future. They're hypnotized by it. Really hypnotized by it. So to avoid that, like, you go out and play golf. I mean, golf's been around for 600 years or more. I mean, it's been around a long, 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 long time. And it's essentially the same game as they were playing back in the 17th century or whatever. I mean, it's at St. Andrews or something. It's just this little ball, and and you hit the ball and hit it, keep hitting it until you get it in the hole, and then you go to the next hole, and play that one. So it's like it doesn't have all this like futuristic gee whiz stuff kind of involved in it, but they're trying to change it that way. They're trying to do it indoors with a virtual golf now that's going to come next year. Tiger Woods and Rory McIlroy are fronting that, and they play it in a big dome stadium. They're going to have like an actual green there for the short game, but the drives and the approach shots will all be simulated. Can you believe that? Simulated. In other words, they'll take a swing on TrackMan, and TrackMan will then simulate the ball flight on a huge screen, so everybody will be watching. Watching the ball like as if the ball's actually been hit, and then land in this virtual fairway, and then from there they'll hit their shot towards the green, and then from their approach shot, then they will actually place the ball on an actual grass surface in the stadium, and then from there they'll chip and putt out on an actual putting green. This is like a virtual goal. This is what's coming in the world right now. Can you believe that? Everybody was sitting in their seats, like watching this. This is so cool. Indoor golf like this. Holy cow. Now just get out and in your golf cart and cruise through the hills and pitch your ball. I once lost 17 balls. It was just being done to just show me something, you know. Don't give up. I said, okay. And it was like a beautiful drive through the hills. It was so gorgeous. It was fantastic. I said, oh, this is so gorgeous. I'm not worried about how many golf balls I'm losing. It was a very strange thing. But I didn't get down on myself. It was really amazing. Almost impossible to lose that many balls. Really. But a once in a lifetime experience. Maybe that has to do with, you know, losing interest. People are losing interest in truth here in the world. They're losing interest. They're getting lost. But I just keep going. I don't get discouraged. I keep going. So okay, lost some more viewers here. And I just you know, it's just the golf course is swallowing up the balls. So they're getting swallowed up by this discouragement, encouragement training. This encouragement towards discouragement training. They're getting swallowed up by it, which is expected. This is what's happening right now. So, rainy day. And I have to just stick around the house all day, yikes. So we're just going to be taping here, you know, providing this great content, astonishing content. It's like, wow, I didn't even know that this would ever be available to us at this point in time. But it is. And some golf courses are just difficult. This golf course was just, it was like extremely difficult. It was after the last winter's extreme amount of rain, huge amount of rough and growth. And it's just like, you know, if you didn't keep the ball on the fairway, you're just gonna lose your golf ball. You know, it's just the way it was. You know, it's just the way it was. So, you know, most of the time it's not gonna be like that bad. Most courses aren't that bad. This was just like an extremely unusual. It was wet too. When I was wet and it was raining partially. And you know, it was just a combination of extremely tough conditions. So I got to experience that, and it did, you know, lost so many golf balls. But I said, it's okay. It's all right. I'm at least I'm out here, you know, playing, and it's gorgeous out here. Holy cow, it looks so nice. Practice yesterday. Was it yesterday or the day before? I practiced it wasn't yesterday. It was the day before, like Thursday. Yeah. I did go practice, like, for an hour. And I just did all the difficult shots, the most difficult shots. Let me see how I can handle like the most difficult shots. And that's what I did. I handled them extremely well, actually. I was like, wow. As I said, wow. I've still got, you know, skills here, even though it's been a long layoff, you know, from this. And the toughest sand shots, I just put the ball like in the toughest places on, you know, the bunker. I was able to blast out a bunker. I never able to do that before. I said, wow, you know, I can get in balls in like heavy foliage, you know, over, you know, weeds and stuff. And I was able to hit out of those really accurately, you know, and just do everything. It's all about just the basically feel the swing. This is the swing you want. And then just do the swing. It's not hitting the ball. It's doing the swing. The ball just happens to be in the way. But you just do the swing instead of I gotta hit the ball. No, don't even think about hitting the ball. You think about doing your swing. So I calculate like, you know, how much swing, the pace, you know, say, okay, and then I just get there and then, you know, get the ball in the way of it and do the swing all the way through. Don't hit the ball and then stop. Now hitting the ball, not even thinking about that. Just going swinging all the way through like that. Works like a charm. Works great if you can do that psychologically. And I was doing that. And that this is what the pros do. You know, the pros aren't hitting the ball. They're making swings. They're making really good swings is what they're doing. And swinging all the way through. Don't stop your swing. You complete your swing. So the best golf advice there is complete your swing. It's just making the swing. It's about completing your swing. And you can figure out pretty much, you know, what the club angle, like how high the loft, you know, you want. and how the ball flight's going to be and stuff like that based on your swing. And then you just, it's all about completing your swing. That's it. That's all you're thinking about, completing your swing. Don't worry about the ball. When you complete your swing and the ball's in the way, the ball's going to jump out. Okay, it's gonna move. It's going to travel. It's going to travel. It can't help but travel. You don't have to make the ball travel. Just complete your swing. The ball is going to travel. It's going to travel. So that gave way better results, really great results to do it that way. And so there's always tough shots. There's the golf course is just going to give you all sorts of tough shots. You just have to, convince yourself, get comfortable. Like, this is the swing I want to make here. Just come upon, what kind of swing do you want here? What kind of swing do you want to put on this? Come to that conclusion, And then just focus on, get the right direction, the path, the direction, and then just to let that swing, be committed to making that swing. You just have to get to a point where you commit to a swing, be committed to that swing, and then just make that swing. And then let the results speak for themselves. Don't have to worry about it. It's not, nothing to worry about. Just do it. And that's the secret to golf right there. So I discovered the secret to golf, essentially, finally. We've been telling this all along, that's it. But we never really quite commit to it. We keep thinking, I still got to focus on it. How do I hit this ball? I'm going to hit it. How hard do I hit it? You don't worry about how hard you hit it. You just have a swing and complete your swing. And then automatically the ball's going to respond to your swing. It has no choice but to do so. So my friends got out and played golf yesterday and it was gorgeous, 80 plus. I think they got it in just before the storm. That's pretty good. Pretty sharp. Okay, so we're just kind of, just realizing that, we can still just be here and at the same time as we're just living an ordinary life, focus on it's desire not need, desire not need, it's desire not need, yes, it's desire not need, it's desire not need, it's desire not need, yes, it's desire not need, desire not need, desire not need, yes, it's desire not need, desire not need, desire not need, yes. Supposed to start raining pretty heavy coming up here. Yeah, desire not need, it's desire not need, it's desire not need, yes, like that. So even when you're making a golf swing, it's desire not need, it's desire not need, it's desire not need. The more we tell ourselves this, the more we become resistant to the discouragement encouragers. So the question right now in the world is who is actually giving this information out, which means that they have resistance to the discouragement encouragers. And so here we are giving this out, which means all this effort I did throughout my entire life has enabled me to keep giving this information out, even though there's this all out discouragement, encouragement ritual taking place in the world. Huge push, encouraging discouragement, saying that it's a need, a necessity, a need. So this is great. This is the fruitfulness of, all that effort. I said, it's going to pay off at some point. And the payoff is that I'm not getting pulled down into discouragement by all these discouragement encouragers in the world. And they're just everywhere right now. They're just saturating every situation in this world. And still, I'm not pulled down by it yet. They're very good at what they do. And they aim on to pull everybody down here in the world. That's their aim. Nobody left behind, right? So I'm open to, you know, additional help. I'm pragmatic about the situation and say, I don't think anybody here should just think like, oh, I'm immune to that. I'm not going to have any problem with that. That would be underestimating the situation, to say the least. These discouragement encouragers are very much professionals in what they do. They're very well trained. And because we have a habituation to go in that direction, to stay loyal to encouragement, it doesn't take much on their behalf to re-trigger that loyalty in us. It doesn't take much. It doesn't. It's easy for them, you know, to push us back into loyalty to discouragement training. Easy for them. So I'm not just assuming that I can stay immune all through and through and through this. I may need to get to some place where I'm not so getting so hammered by this discouragement. You know, I'm asking for that. I don't want to risk getting pulled back into loyalty to this discouragement training. I don't want to even risk that. I don't want to say, like, oh, well, I can't be touched by this stuff. Oh, sure I can. Everyone can here. Those who say they can't be touched by it, you know, man, that's a risky attitude to have. And, so, you know, we're pragmatic here. You know, that this training is, again, we're predisposed through a massive amount of investment in this discouragement training. We're extremely loyal to it. We think it's a necessity. So how can we give up, you know, on a necessity? We feel we can't give up on it. So it was easy to push us back into continuing to participate in this discouragement training. Easy. And these folks are just used to succeeding. These discouragement encouragers are used to success in this. They're used to it. Extremely used to it. They think they're going to get every single one of us to do this. They do. So that their confidence is such that that's difficult to deal with. They just say, "Oh no, you're gonna crumble too. You're gonna do what we tell you for sure. It's 100% for sure." So it's that kind of confidence they have, which is kind of very disarming, you might say. So I believe we need additional help now. Extreme help at this point. Extreme help, absolutely. If you put practicing first, then if you lose 17 golf balls, you know, you're not going to worry about that. It's okay. I'm still practicing really strongly. That's what I, you know, came here to do, really, was just to, you know, keep practicing and seeing some nice sights, you know, out here, you know, out in the hills, and just it's beautiful. I just like driving around a golf cart, you know. It's great. There's no rules on the road, you know, right? You can zig and zag and go wherever you want to. You can turn around, go back. I mean, you're just like free. It's like amazing how the sort of sense of freedom you get from just in a golf cart, being able to just go pretty much anywhere. There's no traffic police. There's no, you know, stoplights or anything. So people enjoy that. That's for sure. People who are like overly regimented, you know, they like to go out on golf courses and drink a lot, and so they it kind of loosens them up, so then they get crazy and just do all sorts of crazy stuff and drive their golf carts into lakes and everything, and you know, they tip their golf carts over and stuff. But they're just trying to, you know, just get free of, you know, all this regimentation in the world, I think, and can't do this on the golf course. I can do whatever the heck I want to do. I can hit the ball anywhere. That's kind of cool. I mean, sometimes you hit your ball in the lake, but it's like, yeah, I can even hit my ball in the lake. I'm free to hit my ball in the lake. That's cool. Nobody's saying, can't do that. Because everybody's kind of laughing, say, ah, you know, the lake got that one. You know, that golf ball was thirsty, you know, that's why it went over there. So there's a feeling like, wow, we're kind of free to do whatever the heck we want to do. I can make this putt, I can miss this putt, that's okay. I can hack the ball, you know, and hack it out of the rough and it stays in the rough, that's okay. Slice the ball into the next fairway, drive over in the next fairway. You're free to do that. You know, so there's this huge sense of freedom in playing golf, actually. There really is. It's really terrific. Especially when there's not so many people out in the golf course. You can even skip a hole or two, you know, or three. Or, you know, just jump wherever you want to go. Right? As long as you're not slowing any belts down or anything like that. But you have all this freedom out there. And wherever you hit your ball, it's okay. Went into the woods. I'll go into the woods. If I don't find it, that's okay. Drop another one. Hit another one. That's good. So a lot of the corporate people are just like super regimented, under the gun, you know, constantly. They like to just go out on the golf course and just, you know, drink to excess and just, you know, just have a wild time and hit the ball all over the place and mess up all the time. And they're laughing, you know, because in corporate world, you can't mess up at all. You know, if you mess up, you're in big trouble. So there's all this pressure on them in the corporate world. Whereas out there, they can just be free of the pressure. So a lot of corporations give golf tournaments to their employees so they can let off some steam, you know, so like, we've been using that for a long time. That's why golf is such a part of corporations, is that their employees, they can have a time when they can just everyone's kind of equal out there, even the boss and everybody's out there, and they're just cutting loose and then back to the corporate grind again. You see, that's how they do it. You get a little break, then back to the grind, little break, back to the grind, that kind of thing. I mean, management is under intense pressure too. I mean, in Silicon Valley now, some of the big tech corporations are demanding that their upper management work 6 days a week, at least 6 days a week now. So they're under, you know, intense pressure. Of course, it's the whole AI thing is, you know, who's going to win? You know, who the winners and losers going to be? That's just an unprecedented market that's opened up. Unprecedented, totally unprecedented. And so there's just a gold rush going on in terms of monetizing it. They're just like, we just have to like work like maniacs to see if we can't, you know, grab a piece of that pie. It must be hell to be in tech right now. I mean, the pressure, I can't even imagine. Don't want to imagine it. But in all businesses, how can we use AI to cut costs and increase productivity, right? That's what's going on here. They're going to be able to, you know, whoever they can replace humans with AI, they will certainly do so. Because it works 24/7, doesn't take any holidays, doesn't take any vacation time, never gets sick, no overtime pay, you don't even have to pay AI, you know, I mean, you don't have to have insurance, you know, pay for that some health insurance, no lawsuits from AI, no discrimination claims, all this stuff, right? So they're going to replace as many people as possible. And, you know, they're desperately working to do that, which will then, you know, streamline their budget, you know, massively decrease their costs, which then hoping to then become super more efficient, increase their productivity. And those are the companies that will succeed, whereas the other ones that don't do that will, you know, probably flounder, left, you know, too many costs and that kind of thing. So, you know, humans are rapidly becoming obsolete in many, many positions. And that's going to, of course, affect the mental health of people. But they'll say, don't worry, here's your virtual reality set and your drug cocktail, and give you a little place to stay and just chill. You know, just chill, enjoy. Yeah. And, you know, they'll have virtual relationships, you know, that kind of thing, AI virtual relationships and all that kind of thing will be happening. Absolutely, it's already happening, marketing it to these lonely tech guys, you know, these pressurized tech guys. So there'll be all these, you know, virtual dating, virtual, you know, online, this kind of thing. And it's just going to become overwhelming, you know, AI controlled, all this stuff. It's just astonishing what's coming in the world very, very quickly. So these are the encouraging to discouragement loyalty folks. They want us to stay loyal to discouragement training. This whole universe is just the training program we have designed to try and train ourselves how to develop the capacity to incapacitate perfection, such that we can then supposedly locate a flaw that supposedly perfection has been hiding from us. So then we supposedly fix that flaw, and then supposedly are able to experience being prior to perfection without this terrible, intolerable feeling of separation arising. And all these suppositions are false suppositions. None of that is true. There is no flaw to find. Perfection. How can perfection be hiding a flaw that it doesn't have? How can perfection be hiding a flaw that it doesn't have? So it's not engaged in any hiding at all. It's completely transparent. Totally transparent. Always equally everywhere. Exactly that. It's not hiding anything at all. not hiding anything at all. So what I do is I imagine if I'm going to be playing golf like at some resort or something, I imagine, what's my anxiety level right now? It's very low. It's very low. It's the lowest it's ever been. Because I'm not focused on, you know, what could happen. I'm just going to focus on my swing. That's all. What's my swing here? And just play. I'm not playing golf. I'm playing swing is what I'm doing. So I just kind of redefine. I'm just playing swing out here. I'm not playing golf. So wherever the ball is, I'll just figure out what kind of swing I need to put on it and just put that swing on it. That's all. And it's just one swing at a time. And then and just enjoy the rest of it. Just enjoy it. It did help that I figured out my swing with the longer clubs, the driver and the fairway woods and the hybrids. And the irons. And figured it out pretty good. You know, it's where the shoulder, you know, it touches, you know, the face, you know. Does it go underneath your chin? Does it go kind of push to the side of the chin, like, you know, push the chin like that? Or does it go over the chin, like your head's down and your shoulder's going over the chin? And I figured out that it needs to just be pushing the side of the chin like that. As you go back, and then the shoulder contacts your chin, and then you kind of turn the chin like that, full turn, and then back. That'll hit it straight. You go underneath the chin, you're going to hit it left. If you go on top of the chin, you're going to kind of slice it, I think, something like that. Other way around. If you go under the chin, you're going to slice it. If you go under the chin, right under the chin, like all the way, like under this, like this, you're going to slice it. If you go like this, you're going to hit it straight. And if you go like this, you're going to hit it left. You're going to pull it left. So you can do shot shaping depending on that sort of angle of your shoulder with your chin. Yeah, that's just my focus. Yeah, that's all I'm focusing on. You need a slice, kind of tuck it under the chin, and you know, aim a little bit left, tuck it under the chin, and just let it rip it, you know. Fade it out there a little bit. I haven't quite worked on my driver shots yet. Haven't had the strength or to do that yet. But you know, it's pretty simple. You just hit a power fade. Should be able to do that. But yeah, I don't need to do too much. You know, you can always hit it straight if you want to. That works usually, although. A lot of the old golf courses have all these dog leg left, like Harding Park, dog leg left, but severe dog leg left. Why? Because when they made those courses, you had these ballata balls, and they wooden clubs, ballata balls, and the whole game was spinning the ball and curving it. So back then, the draw was a big thing, you know, to hit the ball, be able to hit the ball with a draw spin and bend it left. So they have all these holes, they have these severe dog legs left. And if you try to hit it straight, you'll just hit it right through the dog leg into the rough or the woods. So it makes it very difficult, because these days the golf balls and clubs, you can't put much spin on the ball. You don't see many people hitting these big draws off the tee. Almost none of the pros are doing that. If anything, they're either hitting it straight or hitting a power fade, basically. That's what they're doing. They have a hard time working it both ways. So it's hard to play those old golf courses because of that. Harding Park is extremely difficult. Because these guys are just up there bombing it, you know, 330 in the air kind of thing. And they're not putting too much draw on that, right? They're just trying to smash it over everything. And the kids, they say the kids these days, the young kids, like 15-year-olds, they're crushing it. They're crushing it. I guess they've grown up, you know, that's all they know, is that's what you do. And apparently they're just absolutely launching the ball, you know, huge distances. When they come up, they're going to be long hitters. All these big, these long hitters coming up, young guys. The club technology and shaft technology and swing technology and track, man, they've grown up just optimizing everything. So they absolutely know how to optimize everything, and they're training in gyms and stuff. So, you know, they're going to be the longest hitters ever coming up. But they're going to change the golf ball compression so it doesn't go as far. They decided to do that, I think like 2026 or something. It's coming up. So they're literally going to make the golf balls different so that you can't hit it as far. I mean, that's stupid. For amateurs, who wants that? I'm gonna buy a whole bunch of old golf balls, you know. none of us want it to go shorter. You know, we don't need that. And the pros, who cares how much they shoot under par? They're all playing the same course with the same equipment. It doesn't really matter what the score is. If it's 20 under or it's 10 under, it's, you know, the competition's still the same. So, you know, it's stupid. It's really incredibly stupid what they're doing. Amateurs, the whole thing is hitting it farther. That's the whole marketing thing. This will help you hit it farther. all of them. Everybody in the amateur wants to hit it farther. So now they're going to make the golf ball go shorter. Oof, that's amazing. Just hanging out here in the rain, you know. Desire and need. So just been marketing desire as need. To help me keep trying, keep marketing. Marketing desire is need to help me keep trying. Marketing desire is need to help me keep trying. Marketing desire is need to help me keep trying. Marketing desire is need to help me keep trying. That's what we've been doing. We've been marketing desire is need to help me keep trying. Desire is need to help us keep trying. Desire is need to help us keep trying. We've been marketing desire is need to help keep trying. Help us keep trying. Help us keep trying. That's all you've been doing. Marketing desire is need to help us keep trying. And the more you market something to you to motivate yourself, the more you end up believing it, right? You're trying to get yourself to believe it. And this belief can become so strong and pervasive, we end up believing that the belief is true. That it's not a desire we have, but a need to change perfection. We end up believing it's a need. And once we believe it's a need, then we're stuck. We're stuck. Totally stuck. How can we not be stuck? You can't do it. You can't succeed. So you're trying to do what's impossible, but you feel it's a need. You need to do it. And feeling if you didn't do it, you would be destroyed, or you couldn't function anymore. It's an absolute need to do it. So then you're stuck. And then you're just trying, all you're doing then is trying to remain loyal to this discursion program. When you're stuck, when you believe desire is a need, then you end up being stuck. And you believe that your focus becomes on remaining loyal to the discursion program. So virtually everything in this world that goes as teaching is really just encouragement to remain loyal to discouragement. Almost all, not all, but almost all. And you get someone like Buddha coming along who is helping us get past this trouble. But the universe and the world is just completely saturated in encouragement to remain loyal to discouragement. Because we all believe here that this discouragement training is a necessity instead of a desire. That's why Buddha said what it did is like, hey, this is all suffering. It's based on desire. Based on desire, not need. He didn't say it's based on need. He didn't say suffering came from need. He said suffering came from desire. That is so true. It's true back then. It's true right now. Same. This is absolutely true. And trying to people try to have their cake and eat it too. Say, well, let me just like calm my desires down then. Don't let my desires be too strong. We're not talking about desires. We're talking about whether this entire training program is based on desire or need. That's a different thing. People say, oh, okay, I have too much desires. I desire this. I got to stop desiring that so much. That's not what Buddha's talking about. That's not what we're talking about here. Like, I desire to plant some pretty flowers. I desire to go to a nice restaurant. I desire this. So that's not what he's talking about. That's not what we're talking about at all. We're saying, is this entire discouragement training program that we design, this universe, is it, do we need to do this training, or we just desire to do this training? That's what we're talking about with desire. We're not talking about desire to eat some ice cream. So they've twisted it into all this discouragement, encouragement training is to think, oh yeah, you got to control your desires a little better. don't be a little not so caught up in desire. If I just renounce my desires for the world, I don't desire this so much anymore. I don't desire that. That's not what we're talking about here at all. Not at all. We're not telling you, don't go to the store and buy something. That's a desire. That's not what we're focusing on at all. We're focusing on, is this training program, is it based on desire, or is it based on need? Which one? The whole training program, the entire training program. What is it based on? What's its foundation? Is it based on desire? We desire to change perfection, or is it based on need, that we have a need to change perfection? That's what we're talking about. We talk about desire. You don't get liberated by like eating less ice cream and buying less clothes and doing things like that. That's completely superficial. And that's just discouragement, encouragement, giving you false teachings that sound like they're true. I got to cut back on my desires. That's the answer. We're not saying that. We say practice, no matter what you're doing. What we say is, no matter what you're doing, as you're going to eat that ice cream, be practicing while you're eating the ice cream. Like, is it desire or a need? Desire or need? Desire or need? Yes, yes, yes. Keep bringing your attention back to the root of the situation. Is the root of this discouragement training based on desire, or is it based on need? So you don't have to be some ascetic. Buddha went through, all the ascetic training, right? Starving himself to death, basically, almost, and all this torture stuff. And he went through all the meditation, trance state, all that kind of. He said, neither one of those are it. That's all. That's all really. All that stuff is just discouragement, encouragement. Say, hey, if you do this stuff, that's good enough. That's good enough. And so assuages our inescapable attraction to perfection. It tries to assuage that, so we stay loyal to the whole overall discouragement training. So it's just, what is giving rise to this discouragement training? What is it? Is it based on desires or based on need? Is it based on desire or is it based on need? Is it based on desire or is it based on need? Yeah, nice little range. Oh, yeah. Is it based on desire? Is it based on need? Desire or need? Desire or need? Desire or need? Yes, yes, yes. Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Yes, yes, yes. Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Yes, yes, yes. Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Yes, yes, yes. So just focus on just that. It's that simple. It doesn't have to be complex. Making it complex is you're losing it. You're going back to encouraging discouragement, loyalty, right? going back, falling back to that. That it doesn't have to be complex at all. There's this one question. There's this whole discouragement ritual we're engaged in, this ritualistic discouragement training that we're engaged in. Is this based on desire, or is it based on need? Do we desire to develop a capacity to incapacitate perfection, or do we need to develop a capacity to incapacitate perfection? Do we desire or need? Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Yes, yes, yes. Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Is it desire or need? Yes, yes, yes. So, I mean, it's really simple when you hear this. You say, oh, of course. But getting to this simplicity here in this world has been unbelievably difficult, because everybody is twisted and they go back into complexity. They will see it, say, that's nice, and then they jump right back into complexity. Now, this is a singular issue that has to be decided. This all-important singular issue here we have. If it's based on desire, we don't need it. There's nothing wrong with letting it go. It's not going to affect us at all. If it's a need, then we need to continue to be loyal to it until we succeed. Otherwise, you know, we'll be cooked. So, you know, it's all important to focus attention on this. Even if you don't know the answer for sure, realize this is the crucial issue. None of this other stuff is important. This has to be answered. This is the crucial issue. This is the crucial issue, the crucial issue, the crucial issue. Yes, yes, yes. Well, this could be the final ray we get this year, you know. So, I mean, this season, I mean, it's so, you might as well enjoy it. It's very nice to see it raining like this. And then next week is, you know, mid-80s coming. And then, you know, it's going to stay in the 70s. Mid-70s, I think, going forward here. So that's May, maybe May, end of May, you're into summer, so that's when you expect the heat to start happening. But here it usually doesn't get too hot. Very temperate kind of climate here by the bay. But no matter what the temperature does here, no matter what the climate does, no matter any of that stuff is happening in the world, the crucial issue is this whole discouragement training based on desire, or is it based on need? Okay. So putting your attention on this is doing the most excellent practicing. Most excellent practicing. Super practicing here. And not worrying about all this fancy icing on the cake of discouragement and encouragement. See? You know, oh, don't worry that you're still remaining loyal to discouragement. Look at all this. You can, like, talk about it in really spiritual ways. Right? Oh, yeah, I did this yoga retreat, yeah. And we did all this chanting and oming and light visualizations, and it was so cool, man. Wow, I want to do that again. Like, maybe they're having one next year. You know, that's so cool. Meanwhile, I think I want to get a new car. You know, what's our vacation? And, you know, new wardrobe here, and you listen. Like that. What is that? You know, what is that? That's, you get caught up in that stuff. Having just enough spirituality, blah blah blah, to assuage your real inescapable attraction to perfection, functioning perfection, to assuage that. You say, well, you know, it's not so bad here. I've got a yoga retreat coming up. I don't want to miss that. Don't want to miss that. If I experience, you know, Holy Spirit's final judgment, I might not want to go to my yoga retreat. Can't do that. I got to go to that retreat. So we go through life after life after life like this, looking for a window dressing and icing on the discouragement, encouragement cake. So I need to go to this retreat. I need to do this thing. I need to, you know, get a little bit of spirituality in my life. A little bit of spirituality. A whole lot of materiality, some nice cruises, you know, some birthday parties and, you know, socializations and a little bit of drug cocktails and various things like that. So it's not so bad, see, it's not so bad, kind of get through it, you know. Hopefully I helped out the whole discouragement training program by my, you know, being here and then aging and dying. Hope that helped everybody gain some more, you know, discouragement power. Yeah. All right. All this diet is just trying to empower us. You know, all this just an empowerment. It's a belief that we can empower ourselves to incapacitate perfection. So we say, well, we haven't had enough dying yet. We haven't had enough suffering yet. We haven't had enough discouragement. Hang in there. There's big, big suffering coming up. Don't want to quit now. So as they're telling you to hang in there, hang in there, hang in there. It's kind of like fattening the cattle up, you know, before they're brought to the slaughter yards. Hey, cattle, you're not quite fat enough. Here's a whole bunch of great foods. Eat up, eat up, eat up, eat up. We'll even give you steroids to make you hungrier. You're just constantly eating. The cattle's saying, wow, this is kind of cool. All I do is eat this wonderful food, man. I'm getting, you know, this is like great. And then next thing you know, they're on a, you know, they're being transported to the stockyards, you know. So there, and you know, the whole thing is this empowerment, discouragement, empowerment rituals, death, 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 suffering, 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 loss, 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 loss. We think that'll empower us to incapacitate perfection. Yeah. So when you get all these people encouraging to stay loyal to this discouragement program, you got to believe that they've got a whole big old, you know, slaughter coming up in this world. And we're seeing that already in the world, aren't we? We're seeing just huge slaughter in Russia, Ukraine, Russia situation, huge slaughter in the Middle East situation. That's just probably the tip of the iceberg. Who knows? COVID was, you know, just nasty. They don't want you to break ranks, you know, as they're leading you to the stockyard. If someone breaks ranks, maybe other people start breaking ranks, and they'll all start breaking ranks. You know, they want to really contain it. You know, don't make sure nobody breaks ranks here, so that we can get this huge discouragement ritual. You know, here in this world, huge discouragement ritual. Yeah, we'll see if that happens. The drug cocktail thing is coming for sure. A lot of stuff's coming for sure. I'm not sure about, you know, the actual conflict, physical conflict, and all that kind of stuff. I'm not sure about that. Although its potential is there, right? Big time, big time. And there's already a whole lot of that going on. A whole lot of massive weaponry is being unleashed. That's for sure. You know, what's the future? Discouragement, of course. Death. You know. Death. Discouragement. Aging. Sickness. Struggling. Loss of stuff. You know, loss of this, loss of that, loss of that. Homelessness. Just discouragement, discouragement, discouragement. They say, don't give up yet. We got more intense discouragement for you coming. Oh, great. You know, that should help me. Yeah, you're almost there. You've almost empowered yourself to incapacitate perfection. Just a little more in discouragement. You almost made it. And then after you die, you know, you evaluate. How'd I do? How'd I do? And say, well, you know, it looks like you just about, I mean, may have done it. Let me check. We're just checking for you. Okay, so you wait. They're checking for us. Yeah, maybe I succeeded. Maybe I've done enough. I've done enough. And I say, come back and say, wow, well, you know, it shows our record. It shows like you did like a super great job, really great job. And what we see here is that it almost succeeded. In fact, it came like really, really close, maybe the closest ever to succeeding. But it's just like some tiny, you know, just some little thing, you know, that still isn't quite done. You haven't quite succeeded, but it's just like really close. So you just need one more life, you know, and that's for sure that's going to do it. You know, one more birth and aging and death thing, and we're going to, that's going to put you over the top for sure. That's what we're told every time after we die. It's the same hustle. You get hustle. You know you're like in reality, though, in perfection reality, because there's no hustle at all. I had experience of being aware of reality. I said, where's the hustle, you know? Nobody came to see me. Nobody asked me anything. Nobody conferenced me about anything, about what I did with my life or anything. Zero. And I was like, first I was shocked, and then I said, huh, this is pretty cool. There's no hustle at all. And then I started feeling the inclusiveness, total inclusiveness of the situation, total equality, total inclusiveness. I said, wow. And then I started to realize, you know, this is going to give rise to terrific freedom and of creativity here. And I said, wow, I love this. So perfection, there's no hustle at all. There's no evaluating your previous lives, evaluating how you did in your discouragement training. There's nothing to evaluate. You're perfectly free. Reality, you're exactly as you were created to be, in perfect freedom. And so there's nothing to evaluate. There's no evaluators. You're not going to find evaluators there. How'd I do? Nobody's going to ask us such silly questions. How did I do in attempting to do the impossible? What kind of question is that? Equally zero with everyone. It's always that way. Equally futile, completely futile, along with all other attempts of everyone, completely futile. There's only that, just that final judgment that... Oh. So the next practice thing's got to be my driver. Can I handle that? I don't know. We'll see, but can I just hit it straight and shape the ball just a little bit and hit it decent, good distance, drive it out there pretty decently is all you're looking for. That's about it. And I did hit a few last time. I just didn't bring my other driver, the one that's with a stiff shaft that hits it farther. I didn't bring that with me, but I have it in the bag now. That's one, if you're feeling good and strong and you can start hitting that, you can get a little, more distance and better, shorter approach shots. But if you're not hitting it good, then go back to the other one, which is more like a 3-wood sort of thing. Easier to hit, much easier to hit. So I kind of have two drivers, and if the big dog is not behaving, you go to the little dog, and that gives you a bailout right there. With that, really calms your nerves, because if all you've got is the big dog in your bag, and don't play very often, it's going to be like, 90% likelihood that you're not going to be hitting it well, and you're going to have troubles, and you're going to be struggling, you're going to be slicing it all over the place, pull hooking it, and you get all sorts of troubles, and your round of golf is just miserable. You might hit a few good ones, but you're almost good. It's kind of like, well, I hit that one pretty good, but it's fading a little too much, hang on, oh, it's in the fairway bunker, shoot. Almost hit a good one. It's kind of like that, pull around, I almost hit a good one. And the next one will be good. Whoops. Almost hit that one good, but I lost it a little bit too much there. It's like that. The whole round's like that. Whereas if you got the little dog, you say, I'm probably not going to be hitting the big dog well, today. Let's go with the little dog. Pump it out there. Oh, came up a little short of the fairway bunker. That's okay. So you got to bail out there. You got to bail out. So bail out is good. I even have a 3-wood that I can actually hit too, off the tee. That I can hit that pretty darn good. That'll go, get out there a couple hundred yards too. A little, even more accuracy maybe. So it's nice to have options off the tee. I've got three options off the tee. Because again, if you just can't hit it off the tee, you're like treading water all day. You're just trying not to sink. And that makes you nervous and kind of panicky and discouraged. It makes you discouraged. Yeah, you don't want to be discouraged out there. You want to say, okay, I got three options off the tee, actually. I do, three options. I can hit all of them good, but you never know on any given day what you can hit, if anything. There's some days you just can't hit anything. That happens too. Yeah, the way you do that, I would take a 4-hybrid, but maybe you can't hit that yet, I don't know. Then you just basically choke up on the club, play the ball closer to you, and just pray a little bit, or a lot. Are you gonna hit like, you know, like a 500 off the tier, so something that you get out there like 180 or whatever, 175, and just, you know, hit another one and just kind of like just accept, you know, take your medicine instead of trying to keep bashing a big dog, with that can get ugly if you just don't have it. Wow. And then people get really frustrated and steaming mad, and they panicky and all this kind of stuff. So the mark of somebody who's really kind of really well seasoned is, you know, that's just, you know, it's not going to happen. They're not going to lose their cool out there in the golf course, panic, and, you know, like just tantrums, get down on themselves, get all discouraged, get depressed, start drinking, all this kind of stuff. And it's not going to happen. You know, they got options. They got options. Okay. What do I got here? Yeah. What am I going to hit here that's going to make me feel good? What's my feel good club on this hole? Yeah, what's my feel-good club on this hole? And, you know, got options. And then we're just playing swing out here. You know, playing swing out here. So, and if you're seasoned, so you're going to keep your cool, you're going to keep your poise, you're not going to get into that negative state of mind that so many golfers get into. I mean, a lot of golfers are drinking by the third hole, you know. Seriously, it's like, oh, no. Here goes another one of these days, you know. They just start hitting the juice, you know, and that's it. And they're laughing about everything, you know, but then they're laughing, they're up, and then they get manic, and then they get depressed, and they're just like quiet, just like, why did I even come out here? I'm such an idiot. I'm so incompetent, that kind of thing. They get really discouraged. They get very discouraged. Golf, it can be very discouraging. So the very thing that's supposed to relieve our discouragement of our work life hammers us with even more discouragement here. Hammers us with more discouragement. Wow. This rain's a little discouraging, you know. I mean, this is, I was hoping to get out today and relieve the pressure of the last week, which has just been incredibly hectic, dealing with hospitals all week. The whole hospital environment, going to hospitals every day to check in, spending time there, dealing with the doctors and the nurses and the assistants and on. Yeah, and been a week of that. And then a week of, and then getting someone back home, rearranging the room, doing, you know, all sorts of sign-ups and things like that, da, 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 da. But you can see me, I'm still, you know, focusing on what's vitally important. So that's, you know, so no matter what you're playing on a golf course, you know, how you're doing with the big dog, you know, you should be saying, is this desire-based or need-based? 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 That's the crucial element. That's the crucial focus right there. Absolutely it is. So, being able to do that, you're in the driver's seat here. Congratulations, you're being in the driver's seat. So let's see what happens next for me. I don't want to spend my money on clothes because I want to play some golf. You know, that's the thing. I don't know if I can avoid the temptation, you know, doing spending money on clothes, but I don't have any money then to spend on golf. That's the problem. Gee. When I get out there, yeah, I know next week's gonna be warm, so, but anyway, yeah, so great. Is it desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Yes, yes, yes. Just desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Yes, yes, yes. Desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Yes, yes, yes. Just desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Desire-based or need-based? Yes, 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 yes. All right. So, hang in there. Just do this practicing as much as you can. It's going to be supremely helpful for you to prevent you get sucked into this very clever, you know, discouragement, encouragement. So just keep doing this, and so you know what the essential is. This will protect you. This will protect you. Yes, yes, yes.